Hi there, my name is Larry Herb, Xbox Live's Major Nelson. Welcome to show number 580. We are here. Jeffrey's here. Hi, Jeff.
Why, hello.
Now, you know, when we do the show, we have guests and special guests.
We have the special guests.
We have a special guest here today, making a rare appearance, Miss Laura Bessie.
Hey, it's not that rare, is it?
See, we're already getting knocked out.
Hey,
this is not going to be one of those shows.
When I look back on the calendar, you haven't been on in about a month or so.
It has been about a month.
You've been busy.
I've been very busy. I've been on vacation.
Jeff and I got in all sorts of trouble when you were gone.
I heard on Twitter.
Spider trouble.
No, thanks.
Are you noticing all the spider uptick in the Northwest?
There's a spider uptick?
Well, because apparently
you watch the news?
When it gets colder, they go inside.
Oh, I see.
And the story, apologies, listeners, because clearly Laura hasn't listened to the last show.
And the Twitter was saying, don't talk about spiders.
So if you don't like spiders, don't listen for the next 60 seconds. I'm going to give you the context.
Okay.
When I was finishing up Deus Ex, I was really into the last. It was like a boss fight. I'm doing it. And I finished and I was like, oh, all done. You know, the achievements and the credits are rolling. And my back starts crawling. I'm like, what's going on here? And I go into the bathroom, I pull my shirt off, and I have these welts on the back. Apparently a spider during my boss battle was attacking me, and I didn't even, it was under my shirt. Yeah, so it was.
It bit you.
Here. You know what? I didn't even do this for Jeffrey.
Yeah. Do you have pictures?
I think I've got photos.
Oh my gosh.
Look, if I were to be grossed out, I can go to WebMD.
Is this a spider bite? Yeah, just don't search spider bites. Yeah. For images. Oh God.
Channel. Is that necrotic?
I don't know. Anyway, so it just started down this whole rabbit hole. Well,
spider rabbit hole.
Yeah, it was terrible. But anyway, welcome back. Nice to see you.
I am glad to be back. Happy to be back.
You are.
We'll fix that.
It is a crazy time of the year. You know, we're in September finally. Where'd the year go? 2016.
It's now autumn. Isn't it?
In some parts of the country. Or world?
Well, it's the Northern Hemisphere.
The Northern Hemisphere. And I'm going to the world.
Do they call it spring in the Southern Hemisphere?
I believe they do.
22nd? I know the weather is like that.
When you're growing up, does autumn mean spring? Right?
Right. Oh. Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah, right? That's what I don't know.
Like, is red blue?
Well, you know what? I'm going to find out when I go down there.
You're in Australia, you're taking some of that warm winter weather.
Mm-hmm. I am. I've decided to already get out of here, and I'm going down to Australia, which I talked about last week. I told you that, Laura.
Yeah,
right?
You did.
Going down at the beginning of November. But anyway, let's jump right in. Talk about what we're playing. It's been a heck of a week of game releases and finishing up games and playing games. And Laura, I'm going to let you go first since you're back. I don't know if your time has given you the ability to play some games.
It hasn't,
because I know you've been busy.
I've been watching all of the games get released and ticking down like, okay, it's definitely on my list. I want to play that on Xbox.
Now, I sent you...
You sent me a witness code.
And another one for... Did you get the Turing test?
No, but I saw you play that on Twitter.
I finished it.
I want to play that one.
I know. The whole time I was playing it, I'm like, Laura's going to love this game. Laura's going to love this game. Yeah, this is all you.
Are you human or are you computer?
I don't want to answer that question.
Oh, hey.
It was really good. It was from the same guys that brought you Numa Breath of Life.
Oh, yes.
There's much more of a narrative in this one, which to your point, you know, what are you?
Exactly.
And I'll tell you, Jeff, have you played it?
No.
The voice acting is phenomenal.
Oh, awesome.
There's the computer and then there's the female, I guess she's the protagonist. But the voice, her voice is, I don't know who the actress is unbelievable. It's so good. And his voice, he is Jeremy Irons. He sounds like Jeremy Irons, Scar from Lion King and among other things.
He's always a bad guy.
But it sounds exactly like him.
Wow.
Anyway, so.
Is he the bad guy in Lethal Weapon 2?
No, that was Alan
Not
Rickman.
Not Lethal Weapon. Oh, no, I'm Die Hard 2.
That was Alan Rickman.
No, that was Die Hard 1.
Oh, that's a good question. I think you're right. I don't know. We'll check that. Go ahead and fact check that. Anyway, so I'm sorry. Back to what you're playing, Laura.
So I want to play The Witness. It's now out on Xbox One. Super want to play that on Xbox One. I played a bit on PC.
Yep.
Didn't finish it.
Yep.
But now it's got Xbox achievements that I want to go get.
Yes, you do.
Should be super fun. A bunch of awesome Steam games came out on Xbox One recently. Dear Esther came out.
Yep.
Firewatch.
Ooh, in fact, later on in the show, we've got an interview with Sean from, El Campo. Did you know that?
I did know that.
Yeah, he was great. We had a great. We did that a few days ago. He's fantastic, so he'll be on.
Yeah,
You played that?
Yes, I played it.
Did you finish it?
I finished it.
You did?
On PC, yes.
When did you finish it?
I don't know. When it came out?
Every week I ask you, what games are you playing? And you never mention that. Now you dropped that you finished it?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
Sorry, I guess I forgot to mention that one.
Apparently. You got anything else?
When I'm playing, I look at my Xbox One app.
Right, right.
It also
tracks Steam games.
It does?
Yeah. Oh. Well, Win32 games.
Oh, I see.
The beauty of the Xbox app on the PC. Go ahead.
Very good. So lots of great games have come out that I want to play, and unfortunately I haven't had a chance to play them because I've been traveling. Did you tell the folks that are listening what I was doing last weekend?
I think they knew because I'm not even talking to you right now. I'm so angry.
You're not angry, are you?
I'm. So why don't
fill us in?
Tell us. You went to Jeff's favorite state in the union.
I went to Florida.
Oh, hey, welcome. Yeah. Did you go through quarantine?
I don't think she didn't go out.
You can't bring any of those oranges back.
Oh, I see.
You're gonna bring citrus canker out here.
Citrus can't grow. That's no, it doesn't grow.
But you were down there for?
I was down there for the launch of Destination Mars, which is a experience on HoloLens.
That you worked on?
That I worked on. Well, I didn't work on that one specifically. I worked on the product that inspired it, which is called OnSite, which is a scientist's tool to explore Mars that JPL uses.
Yep.
JPL, of course, is a part of NASA, to explore Mars. And the JPL team wanted to give that a similar experience to the public.
Sure.
Because right now, only the scientists can walk around on Mars.
You took me to Mars.
I did take you
Thank
to Mars.
Thank you very much for
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I gave you a demo of that.
Yes,
when we were building it.
And then you threw me off Mars.
I haven't done it.
Oh, you haven't been to Mars?
No.
Oh, it's delightful. Especially when Laura brings you and Laura gives you the tour. It's phenomenal.
I've only been Nobody to the eyes gives, of Matt Damon.
Laura is the tour guide of Mars.
That's very kind. Thank you. So JPL, with a collaboration of Microsoft and a team I didn't work with, took that on-site program and brought it to
created a consumer version.
Yeah. Exactly, which is hosted by Buzz Aldrin.
Yes.
Of course, he needs no introduction, but if you don't know, he's the second person to walk on the moon.
Yeah.
Which is awesome. And Arissa Hines, who is a Curiosity rover driver, so she actually tells the rover where to drive on Mars. So both of those people are the hosts.
It's going to be tough. That's some serious lag.
That's some intergalactic lag.
The good news is that it isn't what you think, which is live driving.
Yeah.
There's smarts on the rover where
it's like, hey, go from point A to point B, and then it eventually gets there.
No, she's got to think 9 minutes ahead. And
right.
She's just put in the, she just steers blind.
Yeah, I'm sure. She's making all these Martian callbacks. You getting this? Laura?
Exactly. Well, I've seen the Martian multiple times.
Did you get to go to the vehicle assembly building while you were there?
We didn't go inside of it. We drove past it. It's the biggest building I've ever seen.
Yeah.
It's really
big. You know, the weather, it has its own weather.
Whatever.
I'm sure it does.
Yeah, like apparently it rains in there sometimes.
Like inside
the building. Inside the building.
It's so big that the water can condense.
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
It rains inside.
You may
that
be just
building?
Spreading rumors, but I've heard that same rumor.
Okay, so if you've heard it and I've heard it, then that's so yeah, it's obviously it's a massive building.
I'll put a link to it.
Go put a link to it raining inside the.
Oh my goodness. Oh, well.
Hey, now you've never been there.
I had been there once before a while ago.
Okay.
To the Kennedy Space Center we're talking about. And that's where the Destination Mars was being launched.
Sure, the Visitor Center. I've been to the Visitor Center.
You have?
Yeah, I went there to watch the one of the shuttle launches. It was phenomenal.
Oh, really? Huh? So you went to, did you go to the second? There's two centers. There's the one where you enter, then you take a bus tour, and it drops you off to where the Saturn V rocket is.
We didn't do that.
Did you go to the big building with the Saturn V rocket?
We did not, unfortunately.
Okay.
Yeah, it was late at night. I was with my mother, and it was crazy.
Okay.
So.
But you saw a rocket launch at night. That's pretty sweet.
Well, actually, we never did.
What happened? Because
it was scrubbed.
Oh.
Because of the weather.
Oh, that's too
So
bad.
We waited until 3 a.m. and then it was scrubbed.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that sucks.
That's disappointing.
Anyway, enough about that.
But yes. So, Destination Mars on HoloLens is now at the Kennedy Space Center.
So, if you're planning a trip there, you can actually go check it out, right?
Yes, you can. It is included in the price of the admission ticket. You just got to go get a reservation for that day. And then you can go and experience Mars. It's open until, I believe, January 1st. So you have to get in.
And then what happens?
This year. I'm not sure what happens after that.
It's only going to be there for a few months?
Yeah, for 3 months. So
what? I can't,
plan your trips now.
I can't imagine something more popular is going to supplant that, but what do I know?
I don't know.
Unless they're going to put you on a rocket and send you to Mars. Why would they? Anyway, all right.
I don't know. We'll see what happens after January 1st, but that's the current planned hours for
it. Was it hot enough for you down there?
Oh my gosh, was it hot. It was really, it was more humid.
Yeah.
And it's been a while since I've been in a humid environment. So I, you know, you forget what it's like. You forget that when you're inside, it's really nice and cool. Mm-hmm. And when you go outside, your glasses fog up.
Yeah.
It's you can't see.
Yeah. It's like breathing through a straw. Like, especially when you first get there and you're like, how do you do this?
Yeah. You walk off the plane, you're just hit with it. Yeah. You're hit with the shower that is the humidity.
Yep.
Yeah. And then you start counting your days by shirts. Oh, today was a 3-shirt day.
Yeah.
Change my shirt.
Yeah, that's like when I go down there. I mean, this is TMI, but I mean, you got to bring like 2 or 3 pair of underwear because you're sweating through it.
Yeah, there was a Lewis Black jag on that one before.
That's right. Anyway, well, welcome back.
Yes.
So, long story short, so you met Buzz.
I did meet Buzz.
Now, does he look as cantankerous, or is he as cantankerous as he looks?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, I could tell.
He does. But it was super honor to meet him.
Of course,
I never
it was.
Thought it, you know, I'd ever be able to meet someone like that. But
yeah.
I touched a man who touched the moon.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Did he pull like a moon rock out of your ear?
Come here, kid.
You got something in there.
Sit on my lap. Look at this. A moon rock. What's that?
What
that? Oh, boy.
No. That would have been sweet.
This is why I can't go to the moon. That's what I would do. Squirrel away a whole bunch of moon rocks.
Just keep them all in your
hands. Keep that one. Keep that under your hat.
Buzz is a,
a legend.
Enough said.
Yes, exactly.
Enough said, so.
Yeah, so he gave a little speech to open Destination Mars.
Sure.
And then he cut the ribbon to officially open it.
Mm-hmm.
So. It was a really fun and special moment.
So when you go there,
I
hope when you go there that the snack bar only is serving potatoes. That's for you, Jeff.
That's for Jeff. That's for Jeff.
Yeah, I'm good.
Potatoes. Potatoes on Mars.
The Martian.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Wow. It took a while.
You should have seen the look he gave. He's like,
I was completely blank. That's right. I was just thinking about NASA. I'm like,
way to
no, the potatoes in Florida are no better than the potatoes here. I can assure you. We're closer to Idaho.
Way to kill a joke, Jeff.
Sorry.
All right.
Oh, one fun fact.
Yes.
If you do go to Kennedy Space Center and check it out, you might see a familiar face. They play a video while you're standing in line, a video on loop.
The queue.
Yes. And they play a video inside. And my face is in the video.
You're in the video?
Yeah, I'm in the video.
Do I know this video?
Why wasn't I in this video?
No, is this the... I remember the reveal video. I think you were involved. So
I was in that one, and they use that footage.
Okay, cool. So this is a... So if you see... here's the deal. I need somebody to tweet me a photo, and Laura, a picture of that, if you're going over the next few months, okay? I need to see this.
If you see my face.
Whip out your phone, and how far are you in the video? Do you remember?
I am at the first third.
First third. How long is it?
It's a couple minutes.
Okay, so you're right at the beginning of it.
Just asking to roll it back, pause.
Yeah, pause. I gotta get a shot.
So
you're fine with it. We checked.
I need you to check that out. Anyway, that's exciting.
Yeah, it's super exciting.
That's exciting. Good for you.
It was really, really fun and super honored to go and
you didn't even tell me this. I was like, I looked on Twitter. I'm like, wait a minute, what? Wait a minute, where? What? Yeah. How? With who? WTF? Yeah, anyway,
I'm sorry we didn't invite you down.
No, please. I don't think you are. That's okay. Thanks for saying that, but I don't think you are. That's very kind of you.
Yeah, so that's what I've been up to recently.
Okay.
Lots of traveling.
Jeff, have you touched any strange spacemen lately? Cranky spacemen?
Not while I was awake.
Oh, boy. Yes. All right. I'm sorry. You finished with what you're playing? That's okay. What about you, Jeffrey? What are you playing?
Yeah, you can't follow up. I didn't meet anyone even remotely, other than you, remotely famous. I did touch some spacemen.
You did?
With my new legendaries that I pulled out of Destiny.
Oh, very good.
Yes. So jumped into obviously the Rise of Iron Rose this week, and as expected, even though I hadn't really played a lot of Destiny in the last 6 months, right back into it, and it's sort of that's my Diablo. I look at you and I get you now.
Oh,
you understand?
You just pick right up. It took a good hour. Like, wait, what is this unit of, some sort of trading resource? That there's just, frankly, an astounding amount of things that you can trade for one thing or another. And it's like, no, that's from the Taken King, or that one's from whatever. So just figuring out what to do. But played through, finished the Rise of Iron questline last night. And that final battle was actually really awesome.
Who'd you do it with?
Played it with a couple of the folks from our LA space.
Okay.
The LA office.
Okay.
So they've taken me through the previous raids and stuff, and when the raid unlocks,
I remember they carried you.
They did. It was only however many sets of footprints. But yeah, so we'll be tackling the new raid, I guess. Is that this weekend? Well, whenever that comes out, we'll be.
Don't ask us. I don't know. I don't know if Laura knows. I don't know.
We gotta get you back into that.
I gotta. I'm headed to LA this weekend. I have no time for that.
That's not gonna happen. Played also a lot of Forza Horizon 3.
Yeah, Jeff and I played a little bit of that. Laura, so you played it?
So not yet.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
That's here.
Be top priority. Oh boy. Oh boy. Just it looks good. Plays good. It's just there's nothing like plowing through the Australian outback in a Centenario, going about 100 miles an hour.
That car is unreal.
Yeah.
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 Were you the one that was saying that the only way you could get a Centenario would be if you already
this car, which we had at E3 earlier this year when we announced Forza Horizon 3, the Lamborghini Centenario, because you have to pronounce Italian, Centenario. I actually had to rehearse this, because when I knew what it was, I had to sit down. My wife speaks fluent Italian, so she's like, we're sitting at the kitchen table. And she's like, Centenario. And she does it really nice. So I'm like, Centenario. No. And again, so anyway, rehearse that. So I had it at E3. But in any event, this car is phenomenal. And the only way you can buy one of them, and first of all, they're all sold out, is apparently you had to pre-own like 3 or 4 Lamborghinis. You had to be an existing owner.
Oh my goodness.
You couldn't just waltz in and go, I want one of those.
That's exclusive.
Yeah, wicked exclusive.
We had one at the booth.
Yeah.
And just it was maybe the most impressive vehicle I had ever seen. Wow. And without even moving.
Yeah, those Lamborghinis, I mean, we've seen them all, in games and in pictures. They look like they're going 100 miles an hour when they're standing still. Mm-hmm. They're just such beautiful, beautiful. They have such wonderful lines. So
depending on when you're listening to this,
yes.
You can already play Forza Horizon 3. If you are listening to this before Tuesday, September 27th,
and?
There is the Forza 3 Ultimate Edition, which you can play right now as we record this.
Yeah.
Everyone else can play if you're having other versions of the game starting this Tuesday.
Yes.
And the reviews were stellar. I think possibly higher than any other Forza game.
I think you're right.
Which is really saying something.
And I think it's now is a good time, because, it's a Forza game comes out that I need to, again, interesting sound. I don't know what that is.
I know where you're going with this already.
That I have to apologize in advance for my drivatar.
Oh.
It is a little aggressive. You've run into my drivatar.
I've already gotten the same complaint about mine.
Is it a little aggressive?
I grew up driving on the East Coast of the United States. This is just the way it is up there.
It's totally different.
I'm used to driving in New York. I'm used to driving in Boston. It's like, get out of my... The horn is there for a reason.
Speaking of horns, you can customize your horn. I'm actually looking forward to less about what cars I'm going to unlock and more about what horn I'm going to unlock.
So I do, what I also have as I was taken for a spin last night was the Warthog.
What?
Yeah, so for the first time ever, the Warthog. Yes, do you not see the videos? I did an amazing video with the Warthog.
No. I missed it.
Yeah, well, so you don't remember this. I told this story a couple weeks ago. When we were down at Turn 10, we were doing a video to announce that you can... For people anybody that plays any Halo game on Xbox One, so the Master Chief Collection or Halo 5 Guardians, you'll get a code, a 5x5 code in your message center on Xbox, and you can use that to unlock the Warthog, and you can drive it in game.
Awesome!
So it's phenomenal. But when we did the unveil, and I'll send you the video, Laura. We were there, and it was just a funny moment, because I was shooting with Dan Greenewald ahead of Turn 10. He's like, oh, I have a surprise for you. And I said, well, what is it? He says, oh, it's right over there. And we turn, and the Warthog is supposed to drive up at that point. So the camera turns to look at the Warthog, and all you hear is, and then you hear the driver go, hold on.
Oh, no.
Pushing it into view.
I have to find that outtake somewhere.
Oh, that's funny.
It's never been shown. But anyways, but yeah, the Warthog is in there, so it was driving that all over the Australian creation. It was a lot of fun.
That game is so good.
Yeah. So
if you like racing,
yeah,
it literally has everything.
And of course, let's be clear, this is an Xbox Play Anywhere title, Laura, which means if you buy it on Xbox, you get the Windows 10 version. It's included at no additional cost.
Awesome.
You can play cross play. So if I'm on my PC and you're on your console or vice versa, we can play together if you'd like. Also, your game save goes back and forth.
Awesome.
So it's fully embracing. It's really extraordinary.
Great. So you can go between PC and Xbox.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so what I would say is, if you're looking forward to being able to play Forza Horizon 3 on your PC. There are some new drivers that NVIDIA released this week that will increase your performance. We'll link
NVIDIA
to that.
Drivers, not drivatars.
Yeah, I didn't really think about that, but yeah.
Just want to make sure.
Thank you, appreciate that.
The clarity. Yeah. Thank you for the clarity.
So that's an Xbox planning. What else are you playing, Jeffrey?
Or
you...
Still playing through ReCore, and still I'm so close.
ReCore. Have you played ReCore, Laura?
I really want to play that.
Okay, Laura, you might want to play some games.
I should play some games.
Do you have, is your console hooked up? Just gotta.
Yes, it is.
Okay,
thanks for clarifying.
Just want to make sure. You know, you've just been so busy with doing other stuff.
And the last game that I am playing, I'm so close on Deus Ex, Mankind Divided.
I'm
waiting for you. Yesterday, where I was jumping on a plane, and they were like, "Before you do this, finish all your side missions. This is it."
So yeah,
I'm coming up on the end game.
I see. So all you need is a spider now. And
yeah, exactly.
Yes. All right, get ready, spider. Man, wolf spider. It's always the wolf spiders. That's what we have.
I don't know what it was.
Yeah.
They're nasty. You should have seen me jump out of that chair.
Oh, gosh.
I've never moved faster.
So we had that whole conversation. And
my
then
skin
on,
is crawling.
On Monday, I was dry. I usually take the bus, but I drove in on Monday. And because I had to drop my kid off at school, and she was like, spider in the car. And I was like, you got to be kidding me.
That's
and
right.
She just smashes it. It was on the back of the headrest. So that thing was. It was ready to pounce. It was in the kill position.
It was ready to go in on you.
Yeah.
But she saved you.
She did.
Thank you.
She's not like me. She has no fear of bugs.
No more spiders. No more spiders.
So I don't know how I didn't ruin that generation. I'm sure I'll find a way.
All right. So quickly, what I'm playing, Forza Horizon 3, we talked about that. BioShock. The BioShock
yes, pack. The whole pack.
Yeah. It's so good.
There's so good games so good. Coming out.
Playing that. Of course, I finished the Turing test. Been playing The Witness, ReCore. You know, something we need to do. Halo 5 Forge came out whilst you were gone, Laura.
Mm-hmm.
And there's
on PC.
Yeah, on PC. It's free.
Mm-hmm.
And it has an achievement for getting seven players into a game. It's like a 100-point achievement for getting seven players into a custom game. So we need to do this.
I've cracked into the top five of my achievement list for the month.
You have?
So we need to keep that going.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Well, we'll have to take a look at that. So
I'm only 13,000 points behind behind Stallion 83 for this month.
I'm seeing you as number four. I'm right. You've got 1850. I've got 1805.
That's pretty good.
13,000 points or 1,300?
13,000.
What? For a month?
He is the world's gamer score leader.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Yes. That is his
That's
job.
That's impressive.
So anyway, so yeah, it's been crazy. Of course, we got some releases coming up this week. Jeff, do you have the latest release list in front of you?
Yeah, so it's quite impressive. We can actually just quickly look back. We mentioned Firewatch just came
out. Yeah, and I want to make sure we get to this. I got the interview queued up, right? So we'll get to that in just a moment.
Sure. NBA 2K17 is now available, and EA Sports NHL 17 is also available. What we've got coming up this month, or this week, EA Sports FIFA 17, we talked about last week.
Available now if you have EA Access.
Yeah, and this is the first one, the first FIFA game to use the Frostbite engine. So there are like real tangible differences in the way the game feels. And from what I've played,
is the stadium going to crumble down?
I'm hoping that if you kick the ball hard enough,
boom,
you could just take the whole century like goodbye. XCOM 2.
Yes.
Is also coming up.
Yes.
Oh.
So this is a game that I played earlier this year and beat earlier this year on PC. They always get me with the XCOM games. I think I bought XCOM Enemy Unknown / Enemy Within on five different platforms.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I mean, so they've got me. I'll be picking this up again. But XCOM 2 is really, really good. It is actually better than Enemy Unknown. So if you played the last one, you will love it. If you like strategy sort of RPGs with super high stakes, you will love that as well.
Yes.
So those two, FIFA, XCOM, and Forza, those are your big releases for this coming week.
That's good. Speaking of XCOM, you know who loves XCOM is E.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you know, I got to get him back on the show. For those of you that missed it, he has a new job.
Yeah, I saw.
He's working at Pokemon.
That's great.
Yeah.
He's working with Niantic, right?
Yeah. He's working with those guys. So he's, he's doing IT stuff. I asked him if he wants to come back on the show, and he's just always walking around trying to find Pokemon. So.
Okay.
You think he plays Pokemon Go all the time?
Well, I can tell you, if anybody follows him on Twitter, that's what he did all summer long. Apparently was a job interview. So
have you heard the song?
No.
You don't know I was quoting the song. It's 1 minute long. I have to play it for you. It's the worst thing ever.
Are we really going to do? Okay, go ahead.
Yes.
If you wish to.
It's an earworm.
What?
25 million views on that It's a boy from, I think, the Czech Republic, and it just goes on and on and on. But now, well, we've been using it to troll other people in the office. We've been missing that. Dan on the Surface team played it for me once, and then it gets in your head. I only played the
first again.
Hook.
Oh, no.
I can do that.
It's
just the previous.
And that just loops.
There's a guitar solo in it, by the way.
Is that the whole thing?
No, it has verses.
Because that's like the bridge, you know, like a stinger or something we would use.
Yes. So when you're on Bing and you just mouse over
a video,
it'll play the first few seconds. Mm-hmm. I love you guys, so that's all I did. But I will show. It's that's up kind. To 30 million views now.
My lord.
It's a phenomenon. And we have to make sure E hears it nonstop in his dreams. Yes. Like I've been hearing.
I'm sure he has. Could you put that in the show notes?
I'm sorry.
Apologies in advance. We talked about Firewatch. Firewatch is out now, which is a game where you play a... by the way, the writing in that is extraordinary.
It is.
Yeah, it's funny because I was...
The voice acting is great.
I was, without a doubt. I was explaining this to my wife. I'm like, hey, I'm playing Firewatch. She says, oh, what is it? I said, well, it's a game where you're playing as a Firewatcher in the late 80s and you know, your wife has dementia. And I started explaining this. I'm like, she looked at me like I was out of my mind. She's like, what? She's like, wait a minute, what? It was just this, anyway, but the writing is really fantastic.
But when do you eat the power pellets and run away from the ghosts?
Yeah, exactly. It's bloop,
bloop. Games have come a long way.
They certainly have. They certainly have. But Firewatch, so why don't we take a break here? We'll get Sean in here, talk a little bit about Firewatch. Now out on Xbox One, and he'll give us the update there. How's that sound?
That sounds great.
As promised, joining us on the line from San Francisco is Sean Vanaman. Sean, welcome. Welcome to the show. It's great to talk to you.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Now, really exciting. Firewatch is out now on Xbox One, and you're the writer of Firewatch, right?
Yes. Yeah, I wrote the game, every single word of the game, pretty much. Maybe there's probably a couple in there that I didn't. But and then I did a lot of the creative direction on the game with the studio co-founder, Jake. And we're a small studio. We're like 10 people, so you do everything. Right. There's gameplay scripting and whatever there is to be done. Yeah, I do a lot
now,
of stuff.
Now, there's folks are probably familiar with your title, Firewatch. It came out earlier this year on other consoles, on PlayStation, and it was also out on PC. But now it's coming to Xbox One, or it's on Xbox One. Let's walk us through, you know, what the game is all about and what Xbox One players can kind of expect from the experience.
Yeah, it's funny. The best way to kind of describe the, I can describe the game really quickly, and then I can kind of talk about some of the like people who worked on it and the sensibilities they have, and I think it might give people a good sense. So, like, Firewatch is a single player, first person narrative exploration game set in the woods where you hike and climb and run around looking for sort of clues to a mystery. You play as this guy, Henry, who has taken this job as a fire lookout in Wyoming in the 80s to sort of get away from his life that's sort of not gone well. And then, like, weird stuff starts to happen. And then in the game, you have a boss named Delilah, who is sort of your only lifeline to the outside world. And as you explore and talk to her, your relationship changes and evolves. And the whole goal was to set out to make a like really like tight thriller, like psychological thriller with a like incredible character story underneath it. Jake and I had been the creative directors and co-writers on The Walking Dead season one at Telltale. So we like felt like we like, character stuff has always been our strength.
You kind of understood what you needed to do.
Yeah. It's like, just go for the gut at every time. Every time you can break somebody's heart, do that. But there's maybe a little bit less of that in Firewatch, but it's still got some heavy emotional themes. I promise people right now, live exclusive on this podcast.
All right, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go.
If I get to write another game, I'm writing another game. It will be less of a bummer all the time. That's like, at least that's a personal goal I'm setting for myself, but we'll see how far I'm able to
I think you can achieve it. I want to talk about, you know, the concept of the game, because folks outside the country or maybe that aren't familiar with this part of the United States is, the you know, being a Firewatch, this is actually a role that still exists today. This isn't just from the 80s. Can you explain what that is? Because obviously you've done your research and how you kind of wound that into a game narrative.
Yeah. So this job, being a lookout, is pretty straightforward in that you sit in isolation in a wilderness area in a tower and watch for fires. And
that's pretty much as exciting as it sounds.
That's right? About where it goes. And I mean, you're talking sometimes like upwards of 100,000 acres that these like ladies and gentlemen are covering, which is pretty like a substantial chunk of the wilderness. Also, I think possibly like our friends in Europe who maybe haven't been to the US or haven't been to the West, at least, or have been maybe to like cities or the coasts. There's so much space here. Like our Xbox players in Russia are like, yeah, we're familiar with lots of space.
Right.
But there is so much land. And when you're in the middle of it, you will never feel more alone.
Yeah. It's it's thousands of acres of uninhabited wilderness.
Like you will die and the world won't care. No one will come and save you. Mm-hmm. There is nothing there. Yeah. I guess Australians would probably understand that too.
Right.
Yeah, so it was sort of that feeling that we thought was a good feeling. It's a feeling you have in a lot of games. It's like right. The way I felt when I played BioShock. Like BioShock is a huge inspiration on this game. Like
right.
Our gameplay programmer worked on the BioShock series, for instance.
No big deal.
So yeah, he's good. That feeling of I am so alone here, and everything that's happening to me is. I can't bounce off of reality. I have to sort of frame it in context of where I am right now. It was a feeling that I really like in those games. It's the stuff that I like sometimes in Half-Life. Right. Those are big like touchstones for us. So there are parts of those games where like I'm not a crazy shooter guy. Like right. I like a good like I mean I love Dishonored. Like I also love the BioShock series. I like and I like Half-Life. But we wanted to make a game that sort of felt like. Some of those moments in the BioShock series where you don't have a gun and you're just thinking and in wonderment and curious about what's happening around you, like Infinite, the opening of Infinite is like yep. stunning with that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that was always a big inspiration for us. So if you like those sorts of moments in those games, like Firewatch is probably for you.
So you're hanging out, you're on the top of this, assume you're top of this mountain with your, you know, with your binoculars looking over thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of acres looking for a fire. How do you make a story out of that?
Great question. You make stuff happen. That's sort of something I've always done where it's like, okay, we have this setup. And honestly, like the inspiration for Firewatch was like, I grew up in Wyoming. I thought fire lookout towers were cool.
Have you ever been up? You must have been up in one.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'd been to some when I was a kid, and then we took the team to a bunch during development. There's a couple in Yosemite. There's one not too far, actually, from San Francisco, which is weird, wow. Up in Marin. It's still used, and it actually looks over a residential / wilderness area, which is pretty cool. I just thought they were like evocative and a really interesting place. They also do a thing that you want in game design and level design, which is like, oh, that's where I'm going.
Right.
You know, and oftentimes like, oh, I need to return to my home base.
Right.
So it does a lot of cool stuff. And then in terms of how do you make a story about that? That was like the first question. Mm. And it was, okay, what's his problem? What's her problem? Like, what do they want? And then what has happened in the world? You just start asking yourself those questions and you pitch yourself bonkers ideas.
Right.
Then you start figuring out what the tone of your game is. So in this game, in the first day of the job, like you're basically assaulted. Right. Like your tower is
under attack.
Under attack. Right. And you're like, what did I do?
Right.
You're like, is this a misunderstanding? Did I just like anger these hikers that I just met? Was it some guy I just saw?
Right.
Like what, why would this, was this a bear? And when you start having those questions as a player both and as a storyteller, you're like, oh, okay, now we have a story. Right. Like why? The answer is just why did this happen?
Right.
And then when that question gets answered, you better have like two more questions. So that's always the way I've tried to write, you know. We also write a lot of stuff that some players aren't going to see. You know, we try to write stuff. There's a real core like story that you're definitely going to experience. The world is open, so you can hike and go wherever you want. But obviously, like as you get to places, story stuff's going to happen.
Sure.
But like questions and plot points of the game don't happen in cutscene. They happen like totally as you discover them. We really tried to keep like non-player interactive stuff to a bare minimum in this game. That was a huge goal of ours. So you have very few, like maybe seconds worth of hands off the controller cutscene type stuff. Like not much at all.
Now, one of the things that I, you know, that we recall when it came out, you know, is that, or last year, is that it's so beautiful. And I saw people making these great wallpapers out of it, and they're going on and on. Talk about the art style a little bit and how your artist captured what the style you were looking for.
Yeah. You know, like so much of the way we do like game and creative direction is just like, what are you good at? And our main illustrator and our 2D artist and our 3D artist are a guy named Ollie Moss and then a woman named Jane Eng. And Ollie just has a really distinct color-based graphic style. And I think he...
It's very bold.
It's incredibly bold. And he wanted to... He's also from England. So he was like getting familiar with the American West while making this game. And he wanted to recreate that feeling of like when you're standing, looking out into the wilderness and... like those like layers of depth of just mountain after mountain after mountain after mountain. And he had done a lot of his style just had that in it. And he's like, I want to apply that sort of like color based layered style to a 3D game. And then Jane and our programmers, Paolo and Ben said like, okay, well let's figure out what we can do to actually like make the like 3D geometry sort of fade into what would be like an Ollie Moss illustration,
right,
as you go further into the world. And I think like I'm pretty just stunned at how they pulled that off, because when you're, let's say you're like in a valley, all the things around you just look 3D and like a video game,
right?
But then through use of just like shaders and a thing we call stylistic fog, they were able to like just sort of blend into these illustrations almost.
Right.
And it makes the world just feel enormous. It's like so good.
Yeah, I mean, that's a part of the tools that a good artist has, is they know how to do. It's a little bit of stagecraft, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, that's so much of that. It's so similar to stagecraft. Like, I mean, I think a great video game, like 3D artist and like a like stage craftsperson have like just tremendous amounts in common. You know, when you're making a 3D game like ours, where you can just whip your head around at any time and look around, you don't get the sort of benefit of fixed perspective that, you know, right, you get like a game like Inside, which I'm stupidly obsessed with.
Yeah.
So I play this game in 20-minute chunks.
Okay.
I play 20 minutes a night because I get to a point where I'm so overwhelmed with, right, the craftsmanship of the game that I get angry, yeah, as a developer. And I go, okay, all right, I just need to not for a second. So I'm finishing it tonight.
Okay, then your mind is about to explode tonight.
Yes, I know. I can't wait. It's so, such a wonderful game.
Anyway.
Yeah. But, yeah, so that's the art of Firewatch.
Tell me about, you know, you talked about the other games you worked on, The Walking Dead, and that is it's fairly prescribed in terms of the dialogue trees and so forth. And this is you know, certainly the narrative is very strong. How did you make the transition from something like that, which is fairly rigid, to what could essentially be an open world type game?
That's a great question. I think I made that transition clunkily. maybe, I don't know. I think I look back now and I'm like, all the things I learned making Firewatch. Firewatch is also a game that if we had any intelligence, we probably wouldn't have tried to make, because we're like, oh, we know how to make games. We like, yeah, let's use a new engine to make an open world first person story driven game.
What could go wrong?
Raise your hand if you've done that. Yeah. I thought about it. Very similar. Actually, I think about it from a sitting down at like my computer, not a technical side, but from a sitting down at my computer perspective, in the same way, which is, okay, we have this like collection of moments. Let's say the game has got like 250 moments, and one of them could just be a 2-second back and forth with Henry and Delilah, or one could be a bonkers set piece that,
right,
you like, as you're walking down a path, something crazy happens. I just sort of try to make all those moments as detailed as possible and just try to write them really well, the same way I would on The Walking Dead. And then the things that we do differently is I then sort of think, okay, inside of this moment, which of this stuff can I like change based on stuff that's already happened? Mm-hmm. So when it does happen to you, it feels even more personal. Right. And then I do, and then I just write little branches, and I kind of have like a markup or like a code I write in like a basically like programming. I just write a code, right. And then I go, okay, I've done that, and now what are all the things in the world that could cause this one moment to happen? And then I like make a list of like, this has to be true, this has to be true, this has to be true.
It's got
to
be believable.
Yeah, well, just sort of like player has to have been here. Player has to like already have this item. Player has to have had this conversation and made this choice for this moment to happen. And then you just sort of drop them in the world. Like literally, like I drop them as like cubes. They're just like triggers you hit. Mm-hmm. And we end up like tuning it way, way more, like way more. But just as like a first pass, I just literally go in and I'm dropping clear cubes on top of a map, and I'm like, it should happen here, it should happen here, and then we play it, you know. So that was the whole new part. But the writing stuff is just like, yeah, just try to like write with brevity, try to give enough stuff in the script that the actors who are brilliant in this game like can latch onto, and then cross your fingers, which is like most of The Walking Dead was just like, we didn't know what we were doing. Right. We thought we're like, oh, well, this game will hopefully find an audience, you know, like,
and how
do good and cross your fingers. So yeah, the actors in this game is a guy named Rich Sommer, who is was on Mad Men from the first episode to the last episode, which is really cool. Yeah. And then Sissy Jones plays Delilah, and she is from The Walking Dead season one. She played the Belgian woman Katja, and now she's like, she's in tons of stuff now. She was in Adrift. She's in a bunch of other Telltale stuff. Yeah, she's awesome.
Now I want to ask you, you know, you talk about Firewatch, which takes place in the 80s, in the late 80s, correct?
Yeah, 89. Yeah.
How do you feel about was it Stranger Things on Netflix?
Oh man. So Stranger Things, okay, this is how I feel about Stranger Things. Stranger Things is incredible because Stranger Things is like, I feel like I'm walking through the woods and there's like a trap that's been baited perfectly to catch me.
Right.
And I'm like, why is that so well made?
Right.
Why is that exactly the way it should be?
Right.
I was never like a huge Goonies fan, which no, I know is probably
funny. Neither was I.
Yeah. So I feel like I don't have the sort of like gushing emotional, like attachment to Stranger Things, but like, I watched the whole thing. Right. And I love how well it's made. I love that it got made. I like that that's like where we are now, that Netflix can let people make stuff like Stranger Things. You know, I think they do Firewatch is a good game and you should totally buy it. So I'm being critical when I say I think maybe they do a better job. Like a better job.
The only reason I don't want to draw any parallels, just Firewatch because it takes place in the 80s and it's narrative driven. And I mean, I don't want to give too much away about your story, but I mean, it's got this parallel. Everyone's talking about Stranger Things right now.
So. Yeah. I think if you like genre, 80s genre stuff, we go for it, you know, like we have like the actual, there's a band in the game, there's a bunch of like diegetic music, and that band is a modern band from LA, and they sell cassette tapes at their shows because they like record all of their audio to cassette first.
Let me just tell you something. I listen, Sean, I don't know about you, but I lived in the 80s and I had cassettes. They're terrible. It's okay they went away.
They're awful. I remember the first CD I ever got, which was Simpsons Sing the Blues, by the way.
Oh, right. Nice. Well done.
I remember hearing it and going like, oh my God.
Yeah.
Like what? Like, why does this not sound like trash? And why is this not falling apart?
And I don't have to rewind it or flip it over. Cool.
They're a nightmare. I hope it's like vinyl. I have a bunch of vinyl now because that's a cool thing everyone has now because vinyl's on the come up. Vinyl's great. But like, I hope cassettes don't do that. I hope it's not like in 5 years
they don't need to,
like Urban Outfitters is like, we got cassettes now, because don't get sucked into that, ladies and gentlemen at home. It sucks.
You heard it here first.
So. Yeah.
Anyway, well, listen, that sounds great. I know that it's out now. Now you said before we got started you wanted to talk a little bit about the release in Europe.
Yeah, we're a little bit delayed in Europe because of a ratings snafu. Our game's a weird game to rate. They did a fine job. It's just like the most bureaucratic nonsense, but it'll be it's coming. It'll be there ASAP. If not right today, in a couple days.
Very soon.
Yes, so please keep checking your Xbox store dashboards. Also, at Campo Santo on Twitter, we will tweet, like, it'll be an obscene storm of tweets the moment it's out in Europe.
And one would almost say it's a firestorm of tweets.
One would almost say that.
And also, obviously, I'll tweet it as well when you guys, or retweet you guys once it's available, just to let the Xbox owners in Europe know that, hey, you can now get your Firewatch on.
Yes. Oh, and also, just the last thing is that... like we've been so excited to come to Xbox.
Yeah.
Since like launch day on February 9th. And the game has a bunch of new stuff in it too. The game has this crazy like multi-hour scavenger hunt / making of mode where you hike through the wilderness and go on a scavenger hunt and find cassette tapes, crappy cassette tapes of like stories of how he made the game, interviews with the cast, and then also like museum set pieces of like, here's how our lighting works. Oh, no. Out in the woods. And then we also, for Xbox owners, we're shipping with a free roam mode that has a day night cycle and some secrets to find out in the woods, and a bunch of new achievements. So that's all coming to Xbox. For the first time ever. So
Well, I got to tell you, on behalf of everyone at Xbox, we're really excited to have you on the console. And I know that everyone's really excited about this game. And I know that my activity feed on the console is just going to fill up with all wonderful screenshots of this game. And maybe I should stream it for a little while on Beam when it, you know, but I can't wait to get my hands on it. Like I said, I've played it on the other platforms. I'm really excited to see what you guys are going to do here, especially with some of that cool new stuff.
Yeah, the new stuff is so good. We started it as just like, oh, wouldn't it be fun if, and then we built full featured modes that we are really, really thrilled about. So definitely check them out. It's also a very streamable game. Yeah. People have streamed, like, there are some good streams out there from like Markiplier and PewDiePie and stuff. They're like, it's a very streamable game because you can sort of act as Henry the whole time. So
now I got to ask you one question before I let you go, because you wrote a game many, many moons ago.
Oh, good.
That I really like. I am a huge Wallace and Gromit fan.
Oh my god.
and you're one of the co-writers on that game. What was it like to work with Aardman?
Oh man, difficult, because that is it's like, what is it like to write for a national treasure when you're 24 years old and don't know any of their language really? It was awesome.
It was a learning experience.
I was this young and dumb. Like, I didn't understand like what an opportunity I had been given.
Right.
I was like, I liked Wallace and Gromit. I just tried to do right by the people at Aardman because they were so passionate and, protective of Wallace and Gromit. And I think that I ended up having a great experience. And I went to England for 2 weeks and recorded the whole cast, which was awesome. For any listeners who don't know what Wallace and Gromit is, it's a claymation British, like sort of like shorts series that has come out over the past.
And if you haven't seen it, you're missing some incredible storytelling, animation, and frankly,
they're delightful. They're funny. It's like got the sort of like Pixar thing where it's like, I'm an adult and I'm laughing at a joke my kid doesn't understand. And they have shorts and then they have a couple features, that are great. Really, really wonderful. That was my first actual shipped game I ever wrote.
Right.
Because I made a bunch of stuff that never shipped before that. So Wallace and Gromit was like the I am gonna ship a game goal. And then I shipped Walls and Gromit episode 3 Muzzled on the Xbox 360.
That's right.
Yes. It was an Xbox exclusive.
That's why I do remember that. That's why I remember, because being a big fan of Wallace and Gromit, when I remember that game coming to 360, I was like, oh my God, and I played it and I just had the greatest time with it. So I just wanted to thank you. Of course, you've done a lot of other stuff. You did Tales of Monkey Island and Sam and Max.
That's the peak. Let's talk about that. Walls and Gromit. I peaked early, man.
That was your first one of your first big projects. You can't peak then.
That's it. Sorry, Walking Dead is trash.
All right, Sean, I'm gonna let you know what I think. That's
on the record.
It's off the record. All right, Sean Vandeman, I appreciate you taking the time. You are, of course, the man behind the studio that's bringing us Firewatch this week on Xbox One, and then coming out shortly, very, very soon, Xbox One over in Europe. But I want to thank you for everybody at Campo Santo for all the great work on this, and great to have you on the platform.
Thanks so much. I'm excited to be here. Son of the platform since the 360 days with Wallace and Gromit. Very excited.
Thank you, Sean. You can find him at Vandeman on Twitter if you want to check him out. And he'll talk about Firewatch. So check Firewatch out on Xbox One now. Thanks, Sean.
Yeah, it was a really, really beautiful game as well.
Mm-hmm.
Just gorgeous.
It's on my list. I've got to download
definitely
it.
Definitely play it.
After Deus Ex, jumping on it.
There's no raids in it.
No, there's no raiding.
Yeah, but what kind of like legendary gear do you get?
Yeah, right. Okay. You think you get some rope and a pine cone.
You do.
Did you find the turtle? Did you find the turtle?
No.
Really? There's an achievement for finding the turtle.
I didn't find the turtle.
Yeah, so you might
have to go back and play on Xbox to get the achievement.
Yeah.
Go back and find the turtle. All right, Jeffrey, we got some headlines, and then we got to get to name the game because that's
it's
over.
It's been a while.
It's been a month.
So the original foundation of Microsoft, I think the original credo or what would be the word, mission statement,
yes,
was a computer on every desk.
That was Bill's statement. Yeah,
yeah.
Bill Gates.
So I feel like this holiday we've got an Xbox One S for every gamer, and we have had bundles. I picked up the Halo Xbox One S bundle. We've got ones coming out for Gears of War, FIFA 17, Madden bundle. We just announced this week a Minecraft favorites bundle.
That's great.
So that actually has like the best box art I've seen on a bundle. It's completely, yeah, it's right there. It's kind of completely taken over by Steve and, I can't remember her name, from Minecraft, the other avatar.
Oh, yeah.
Alex, maybe? Anyway, so there's a 500 gigabyte Xbox One S bundle.
Yes.
And of course it comes with Minecraft Xbox One, and as well as a bunch of skin packs and texture packs and things like that. So that is available now.
Yes.
And in other Minecraft news, for the version of Minecraft for Gear VR, that is the virtual reality that works with the Samsung, one of the Samsung phones,
yep,
now has Xbox wireless controller support. So
yay.
If you wanted to control that with the world's best controller,
yes,
you can do that. And I believe you need an Xbox One S controller, correct? Or the newer
the one
model
with the Bluetooth stack in it.
Yes, exactly.
which we've been phasing in since we announced it at E3. So
exactly. So if you have an Xbox One S, you could do that. Or if you had picked up one of the Xbox Design Labs, that's that.
Those
model
all have
controller
it too. Yeah.
Oh, good.
So
you have one, right, Laura? You designed your controller.
I didn't order it. I need to order it.
It's sitting in your cart. You
it
haven't
is
checked. Really?
I haven't checked Go yet.
Oh, that's. Why don't you work on that?
I'll work on that.
Okay.
Cool. And we announced this October's Games with Gold.
Yes, we did.
So in time for the end of baseball season, we have a Super Mega Baseball that will be available.
Each
on
one of you
one
can be Mr. October or Mrs. October.
Yes. I'm just thinking of Reggie Jackson.
That's exactly right.
In The Naked Gun.
That's exactly
when he tries to kill the queen. Like that. That's all I could think of. Because like Reggie, like most of his glory years happened before I
sure
was really sentient.
Sure.
But, you know, when he was playing for the Angels. When
he had a candy bar. He had a candy bar, you know.
He did?
Yeah.
Really?
Go look it up. Reggie Jackson.
Reggie Jackson.
I think it's called Reggie, yeah.
What?
Yeah.
But they used a mind control device, Ricardo Montalban did, to get him to kill the queen.
Okay.
He doesn't. Spoiler alert. He doesn't. What a great movie that was. The Escapists will
that's
be
a good
out
game. It's super fun.
And that's in the middle of October through the middle of November on Xbox One. And then
yes
for Xbox 360, mm-hmm, we have Reflex MX versus ATV.
Mm-hmm.
And then also I Am Alive.
Yes.
Oh.
Okay.
Very alive good.
Those are free. If you're an Xbox Gold subscriber, you can get those games for free right now. Go get them.
And one last announcement.
Yes.
So I have been, and I don't know about you, but I've been staring longingly, wistfully at the new gaming laptops that have come out in the last couple of months. Ever since the mobile Pascal chip,
yes,
mm-hmm, by NVIDIA, mm-hmm, was announced.
It rocked your world.
Where everything went from the 900 series to the 1000 series, 1060, 1070, 1080, mm-hmm, where they were like, they can make the laptop smaller now. They're pumping out way more frames per second and resolution and use less battery power. And I'm staring over at what I used to love, my laptop.
Aww.
With my 965 in it. And now I'm like,
well,
you're lazy.
It's great.
I'm using it to play Forza Horizon 3. I'm using it to play ReCore. I used it to play Quantum Break earlier this year. It does, mm-hmm, the job, but it's no longer top of the line.
Right. Well, that is the constant struggle in the technology industry.
That's very true.
I know.
And we want our phones smaller. We want things faster. We want them lighter. You know, the whole thing.
And I want one of these 1080
I know
laptops.
You do. I know you do.
I need
I know
it.
You do.
I need it. Well, anyway, so Strudy,
you know, I have
to pick one up.
I kind of have a 1080 laptop.
You do?
I do. Because I have the Razer Core.
Oh, you
and I have a 1080 in it, and I have it connected to my stealth, so
that does the job.
Kind of. That's why I say kind of.
If you're like me and that you want one, and you're not like me and that you you actually just go for it, you grab life by the whatever you grab life by, and pick up one of the GeForce GTX 1080 or 1070 graphics card systems or laptops, you get Gears of War 4. It comes with it now.
Yes.
Oh, awesome.
So if you are going to be picking up one of those new awesome shiny laptops to play Gears,
consider that.
Oh, yeah, it looks so good. By the way, we showed it at PAX.
Yeah,
so good.
By the way, congratulations to the Coalition. Game went gold this week.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah, so they had everybody up there. Did you see the picture?
No.
Satya was up there.
Oh, I did. Phil, I did see that. Okay. I saw that picture.
Terry was there.
Yes, everybody was
Yusuf
there.
Yusuf was there.
Yusuf was there.
Blaine Howard was there.
Our good friend Blaine dressed up in full Cog Arbor.
Yeah, he's the guy over on the left side.
Yes.
I know.
And then he started rampaging around Vancouver in you know, dressed like JD.
Yeah, that's going to go well.
Yeah, well, they're
did polite. He get over the border in that outfit?
I think he probably had to leave it behind. But he was bragging that they actually made the armor to his specifications.
Of course they did. Of course, so he thinks.
Yes. He would hear this, except he's in the gym right now.
Right.
So I guess he kind of earned it. Yes.
Well, we're playing an audience of one right now.
Yeah.
Laura's even checked out of this one.
Blaine's not making fun of Blaine.
So, all right, go ahead.
So that's your news for the week.
All right, that's the news for the week. It's a lot more going on. I want to talk a few things. As I said, kind of alluded to earlier, I'm headed down to Los Angeles. By the time you listen to this, I may already be back. Mm-hmm. We're going to be down there at the Peterson Automotive Museum to launch Forza Horizon 3. Very excited. I've never been to the Peterson. Apparently, it's quite the car museum.
Really?
Yeah, there was a feature on Wired. They completely redesigned the museum in order to be able to move the cars around. So it's got some of the more like most elaborate car elevators in the world.
Awesome.
It was a really cool feat. I'll see if I can find that.
Yeah. I'm going to check those out. So it's going to be open to the public. I'll be down there. The following week, which is next week, I'll be at TwitchCon. Going to be doing some can't talk
That's
about
why,
what I'm doing
yeah.
there yet, but
yeah.
we're going to be down at TwitchCon, which is in sunny San Diego.
We'll just say look for us.
Look for us. Yeah, look for us. Just follow me on Twitter, as you know. Then following that, I'm working on a Gears launch event. So Gears will be launching. I'll be doing that event. I don't know where that is. I think it's in L.A.
A lot of travel to California.
And then after that, And then after that, I'm going to, I think I talked about going to Australia for PAX.
Yes.
Very excited about that, Laura.
That's going right, because you're keynoting.
I am. They call it story time. I have a surprise. I'll tell you off the air. I don't want to tell people, but I do have a cool surprise.
Awesome.
So just a little something. You know, you can't show up to a country empty handed.
No.
It's just bad form.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to be bringing a little something for the entire country. It's a diplomatic mission. I'll just say that. Anyway, I've got a lot going on travel over the next few months. So apologies in advance for the sporadic and sometimes incredibly inconsistent show schedule that we have. You know what? I was asked, we need to do a Google Hangout or something,
because
we haven't done some time. And
we're talking about Beam, right?
We were thinking about doing it. Yeah, because I was actually talking to because we bought Beam. I was talking to the Beam guys. What we can do is kind of connect all on Skype. And then I can just broadcast my Skype channel, my Skype thing. So
it seems to work.
Yeah. So I was thinking about maybe we should test that out one time.
Yeah.
But either way, if you want to see us, I mean, who doesn't, right? then we'll work on that as well. Because then it's a little easier. Because then when I'm on one side of the planet, Laura's hanging out with a cranky Buzz Aldrin, and Jeff is whacking spiders in the back of the car. we can do a little something with you guys when we're not doing a show. So anyway, hey Laura, we have a name of the game, you know.
We do.
We have one that's got to blow the dust off it. So
yeah.
You ready with
Pick
that?
Back up. Yeah, let me blow the dust off my tape player here.
All right, and you hit the play button. That's the big one with the triangle pointing to the right.
Thanks. Well, let's roll the tape from last time. That was Name the Game from last time, and it was F1 2016. Exactly. Not too difficult of one, but nope. Larry, can you tell us who's won?
Sure can. Well, this is interesting. His gamer tag is Grug, and he is from Queensland, Australia. How convenient.
Oh, okay.
That was unrelated to, he was randomly chosen.
Yeah.
You're going to meet Grug.
I'll hand
him his prize in person.
He won you want to know what he won?
Yes.
Oh, this is unbelievable. He won a copy of ReCore, Firewatch,
awesome.
BioShock Collection, and the Turing Test.
What?
But you know what I just realized as I look at this, and he's from Australia. How can I not throw in a copy of Forza Horizon 3?
Right?
Right? Right.
Mandatory.
Mandatory. I'm going to do that. I'm also going to include one of those mini Lambo cars that I gave away. Have you seen those?
No.
If you look on my Instagram, did you see it? Hold on, I'll show it to you.
I don't know if I follow you on Instagram.
I'll drop it in the show.
Okay, well, that's another problem. this is, I gave them away in my free code Friday last week. We have little ones. So oh. it's little models.
Oh, little models of the Lamborghini.
Take a look at what I posted.
Got a real little Lamborghini to give away. That's really funny.
So anyway, so we I'll get thrown one of those.
That's
anyway,
great.
Congratulations, Grug. You got yourself some cool stuff.
Yes.
Now there's people listening right now going, oh, I want to win cool stuff. How do I do that, Laura?
Absolutely. Well, we've got a great little game for you to play, and you too can win fabulous prizes. It's super simple to play. All you have to do is listen to the sound effects that I'm about to play, yes. And then send us an email with what game you think those sound effects are from.
All right, so let's go ahead and play it, and we'll give you the email addresses on the other side, all right?
Sounds good. Let's roll this next Name the Game. Like we said, it's super easy to enter this game. All you have to do is send us an email. Send me an email at lollipop@xbox.com and ccmajor@xbox.com. Include what game you think those sound effects are from, and we will randomly choose you if you're right.
That's right. And if you're wrong, you'll get nothing and like
exactly.
it. So, but good luck. It's pretty easy.
Yeah,
we try to make them easy, but hopefully you can win there. So. And we got prize to give away, so thank you for that. And if you, a lot of people ask, well, can I enter? If you can hear our voices, you can enter. If you can send email, you can enter. Don't bother us on Twitter, because that's not considered an entry. I mean, you're welcome to bother us on Twitter, but just don't do it for Name the Game, because we're not going to.
Because we can't quite catalog that
right,
easily.
Right, you got to send email, as Laura just pointed out. So congratulations to the winner, and good luck to you, my new winner somewhere out there in the vast, vast listening audience.
Exactly. Good luck.
Look at the look of pensiveness on Jeffrey's face. I don't know what he's
doing. I'm reading a Reddit thread in which you were invoked, which happens a lot on Xbox One. Yes.
You can invoke the Larry.
Yeah, yes, and it's frequent.
And the comments are after you jumped in, right. As you, mm-hmm. you do. There's sort of like a running joke on that thread that it's like Candyman. If you say Major Nelson three times in a mirror, you will appear.
Right.
And that basically is what happens. And they love you for it.
Other nice
and
guys over just there, a girls. Comment,
some funny stuff on there.
Okay.
I'm glad. Yeah, I'll read it.
I'm glad I could provide you online and offline amusement. Whew, all right then. So we're kind of getting towards the end of the show here. Mm-hmm. I've got to get to LA. I got a plane to catch.
You do.
Laura, you've got I don't know what you've got to do.
Work to do, you've probably.
We've got other work to do, and Jeffrey has
Reddit threads to read.
I got Redditing. It just keeps going.
You know, we haven't really talked about much of the gadgets. You know, if we've got phones or, you know, so I know the new iPhone's out. A lot of people are excited about that. The new iOS thing is out with the messages. We've been playing around with that.
You've been playing around with that. Not every text needs lasers. That's all I'm saying.
Not true.
A lot of them do.
Balloons.
Yeah,
confetti.
I actually sent that to someone. It was their birthday, though, yesterday.
So. Okay. Well, by the way, apparently, if you just type in congratulations or happy birthday or happy new year, it'll automatically happen.
Mm. Oh, really?
Yeah, a little tip there. That's what my wife actually found that one out.
I was like, be careful not to do that during like a solemn occasion.
Right.
You know? Yeah. Yes. Like, I'm very sorry. Oh, balloon! Yeah, you feel better now.
Woo! Animated GIFs. I don't really have too much to share. I've got a couple things I'm working on. I'm looking at some new, as always... Some new networking hardware. Ubiquiti is working with those guys for some new stuff. Yeah, some pretty high end stuff. So
let us know what you think.
Yeah, as always, you know, right now I'm really happy with my home network setup. Mm-hmm. It's been the guys from Eero. You know, I think I talked about that on
previous shows. Yeah, you talked about
Eero. So those guys are great, and I love my Eeros. What else? I think that's about it. You know, right now I'm just at that awkward moment where I need to get an HDR TV for home, but it's not.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, starting to casually look around.
Don't do that. That's just like, it's like, it's
I'm
like
not on the AVS forums.
No, okay, okay, yeah,
that's when you've gone too far.
That is when you go, you know, the AVS forums.
I do.
Yeah, when you go to the AVS forums, that is, there's no turning back.
Yeah,
there is none.
It's like you're all of a sudden, it's 3 a.m. and you're 472 pages in on this thread.
Yes, I do need the $10,000 version
of how to calibrate your TV. God, is it bananas. Anyway, other than that, it's, you know, it's kind of, we're just focusing on the game releases. And as I said, we've got a lot of trips planned, some events.
Yes.
Some game launches.
Exciting things in the future.
Yeah. You know what else I started talking about? This is going to blow your mind, Laura.
Okay. I'm ready to have my mind blown.
I didn't even tell this to Jeff. I started talking about E3 next year with somebody.
What?
Yeah.
Wait. Like for real?
Yeah.
Or just casually?
No,
like,
no. We're just talking about, hey, we should do this for E3.
It's September.
Yeah, I know.
Wow.
I know.
9 months. You could make a baby between now and the next
E3. I know.
E3. Could.
Okay. That's.
That's. I mean, it's a long time.
That went a different way than I was expecting, but it is.
Yes.
And although,
well, look, when you say
although
months,
I think the gestation periods of the blue whales is longer.
Yeah, it's a couple of years.
Yeah.
Same thing with an elephant.
Yeah. Really?
Yeah.
I had no
What's
idea.
The, what about the spiders? What did
you... about 5 minutes.
And it releases 10,000 of them.
Lays the eggs in your ear.
Now yeah. I've told this. Speaking of spiders, I have told this story.
The spider podcast.
Yeah.
I have told the spider story of the Christmas tree, right?
No.
So this is, I'm pretty sure I told this one. If you don't like spiders, I urge you to fast forward about 90 seconds.
I think they've already unsubscribed.
So I'm sorry, but I thought I should have shared this last week. But so this happened when my wife and I lived in Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
She loves Christmas and the real Christmas tree. So she went out and bought a real Christmas tree. Mm-hmm. And this is like the first couple of years we were married. And she's like, I'm going to bring a Christmas tree home. So she brought the Christmas tree home. She sets it up. She went out to the farm. They cut it down. She brings it into the house. She sets it up. And obviously, this is, November, December. So it's warming up. And if the water starts coming off, she's under the tree trying to get it into the little tree holder. And while she's under it, she feels this water getting onto her head. And then she looks up. There was a spider nest in there. Because it was warm, they started hatching. Thousands of spiders are spilling onto her face.
Oh, my God.
So, getting an artificial tree this year.
We've had an artificial tree ever since. This is a true story. Yeah, that was fun.
I couldn't live my life without that story.
I'm telling you, so that's why. It can only happen there because it was warming up and that they got into the house and it was a bad, bad scene.
Oh.
So we burned that house down. And
yeah. And that's how you ended up in Washington.
That's how we had to move to the other side of the country.
We'd be here right now.
Oh, my God. All right.
No, thanks.
Seriously.
I feel like between now and the time we go to Australia, we should have a spider of the week.
Apparently 10,000 baby spiders on your face feel like water, Laura.
Oh, no.
I feel like 10,000 baby spiders is like a Cards Against Humanity. That's like the first part of one.
Yes. Yeah.
All right. Can you give us some eye or ear bleach, Laura, to get us out of this?
Right?
Tell us about space or something.
No. All I can think about is tiny baby spiders in my ears.
No. Don't do that.
That's all I got. I cannot steal myself away.
I think only one thing could save us.
Yes. All right. We're going to get out now. Here we go. Go ahead. Go ahead. Let it go.
Take the spiders away.
Take the spiders away.
Oh, keeps going.
I want to catch you.
Boom. All right. I'll have to put the clean version of this in there. All right. We're going to wrap the show up here, Laura. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for finding time in your schedule.
Thank you for having me back.
Welcome back from Mars.
Thank you.
In Florida. By the way, I think Florida is a weirder place than Mars.
Possibly.
Our new segment, Florida or Mars.
So, and Jeffrey, thank you.
Water has been discovered on both. Right? The similarities don't stop there.
Oh, boy. Okay, before we get into another weird place, we're going to stop now. Thank you, Laura. Jeff, thank you. You can follow Jeff on Twitter at
Jeff Rubenstein.
You can find Laura on
at Laura Lollipop.
You can find me at Major Nelson or the Spider-Man. We'll talk to you guys next week. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye. I play Bogus.